I have personally briefed a sitting director of Central Intelligence, James Woolsey, President Clinton's first CIA director. I have personally briefed the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, the head of Intelligence Joint Staff, members of the Senate Intelligence Committee, many members of Congress, members of the European leadership, the Japanese cabinet, and others. And what I have found is that none of them are surprised that this is true, but they are uniformly horrified that they have not had access to these projects.
We have created our reality here, and we have created it right now rather badly, for it's not a sustainable reality. We have created with our science and technology, instead of using it for the greater good, it's been captured by interest, greed, self-service, which is rife, and instead of using it, all of our technology and our brilliance and genius for greater good, we use it for self-service. So that's not going to work.
From that moment on, I could never put it down. I could never step away from it. The more I learned, the more I wanted to know, and the more I ended up knowing, the more shocked I became. And as I said, my old world view collapsed. You talk about the word alienated.
You had at least three types of the grays. You had some that were much taller than we were. The unique thing that I'd like to point out for the most part is that the entities that we did catalog were in fact humanoid. Now this created a situation where the scientific community was trying to figure out why that would be the case, because you would expect that if life evolved on other planets, that they would take on some type of other being, so to speak, not necessarily look humanoid or be bipedal such as we are. But apparently, we got quite a few of the species out there that are humanoid in appearance, and that creates a question that yet has to be answered by science.
Reagan's scientific staff, three CIA people, three FBI people, and I don't remember who the other guys were, along with all the FAA experts that I brought with me that could decide or talk about the hardware and the software, how it worked, we put on a dog and pony show.
In that we had ground visual, ground radar, airborne visual, and airborne radar confirmation of some of these sightings. The individuals who made the sightings were everything from airline pilots, military pilots, police officers, some of the people that your lives depend upon on a daily basis. These are very reputable and credible people. I hope that the testimony here from very credible people will convince you of that.
Clearly in these photographs were structures, mushroom-shaped buildings, spherical buildings, and towers. And at that point I was very concerned because I knew we were working on compartmentalized security. He had breached security, and I was actually frightened at that moment. And I did not question him any further. And a few moments later, someone did come into the room.
It sat there for about 10 minutes and then slowly descended until it dropped off the radar. It was gone for about 5-10 minutes. And then instantly reappeared at 80,000 feet, stationary. The next sweep of the radar, it was 200 miles away, stationary. It hovered there for about 10 minutes and redid the whole cycle twice more. When I found out what the normal, what you normally do when you see a UFO, I was told that you notify NORAD, you don't necessarily write anything down, you don't write anything down, and you keep to yourself. It's a need-to-know basis only.
We have been a detection about 5 hours, more or less, on a radar and a new equipment that we believe that that equipment was working in not a good way, because it's not human that you have detection by 5 hours of the same object and apparently without movement. Well, we concur with the technical persons of radar in our country that the radar system was working well, and it was very exciting, and we surprised when the next day we received information about a periodist named Jaime Maussan that is studying these cases in Mexico. about that sighting from a lot of people in the Metepec city. There is another point located southeast of the Toluca airport about a sighting of the big flying saucer, apparently 50 meters of diameter. Then for a lot of people.
Aquí una comparación con el video de Pedro Hernández, que dura 2 minutos con 40 segundos, y el de Alfredo, 2 minutos con 5 segundos. Con la filmación de Hernández, el sol le pega de frente a estos objetos y por ello se ven amarillos rojizos. Recordemos que está atardeciendo y que fue tomado desde la parte norte, mientras que Carrillo lo toma a contraluz desde Azcapotzalco. Estos dos lugares están separados en línea recta por cerca de 6 a 8 kilómetros.
¡Caramba, hombre! Una de ellas ve a usted, le da la vuelta completa y se va, ¿no?
As you know, every year we have been presenting the UFOs very close to the projects in the space. Santiago has taken the task to record the full missions in the space. The Atlantis was able to record this light that came from very far to very near, stayed there for a few minutes and then left. It happened again on the next mission, STS-116. On December of that year, when two new warnings happened, when these objects got very close to the Discovery and International Space Station. How can we interpret this? And now we have this crash between two satellites, an impossible crash. The space trash that is in the space is not floating anywhere. It is controlled. They know exactly where every single one of these crafts or remainings of old missions are. It means that was not accidental. How can we know this is truth? Well, let's watch. Let's see, because I believe this is not going to be the last time we see something like that. In October 2007, the whole mission was observed. This is just very few videos. We have presented this in the past, but we want to prove that we are being watched in the space.
We believe that we're not alone, and have for many, many years, even though, but at the time I went to the moon, it was a conventional wisdom, both in science and theology, that we were alone in the universe. We're barely out of the trees, even though we think we're rather sophisticated. But I do like to tell the story that my great-grandparents came across from southern United States to the west after our Civil War. And I went to the moon, yes, less than 100 years later. They came across in covered wagons. So from covered wagons to going to the moon in less than 100 years in our lifetime is a rather significant event that tells us how primitive we have been until the modern era.
And it's available for the Congress to review and for the major media to review. We can establish that this subject is real and has tremendous significance for the human future.